Hello everyone, this is Dr. Mohsen and our lecture today will be on the clinical correlates of anterior abdominal wall and inguinal region. So what is a hernia? A hernia is a bulging of the part of the contents of the abdominal cavity through a weakness in the abdominal wall. Basically we have the abdominal wall, and wherever there is a site of weakness, the contents of the abdominal cavity such as peritoneum or intestines, they can bulge through that, and that would constitute a hernia. Hernias can be caused by design weakness of the abdominal wall, weakness due to structures which are entering and leaving the abdomen. It can be due to developmental failures or genetic weakness of collagen. It can be due to any sharp or blunt trauma, so even after surgery. It can be due to weakness which occurs due to aging and pregnancy or any neurological and muscular diseases. And hernias can also result from excessive intra-abdominal pressure. In this picture, you can see that we have the abdominal wall over here. And this is a loop of intestine that has come out from the abdominal wall. It is covered by peritoneum as well as layers of the abdominal wall, and this is a hernia. So what are the parts of a hernia? The parts, any hernia has basically three parts. We have the hernial sac, which is the pouch or diverticulum of peritoneum, which consists of a neck of the hernia and a body of the hernial sac. Then we have the contents of the sac. The contents can be any structure which is present inside the abdominal cavity. In pediatric hernias, it can be nothing, just we have an outpouching of peritoneum. Sometimes we might have omentum, sometimes we might have intestine inside the sac. We might have also viscera such as urinary bladder and ovaries or the appendix inside the hernial sac. And the last part of the hernia are the coverings of the sac, which are formed by the layers of the abdominal wall through which this sac is going to pass through. The neck is located at the innermost musculoaponeurotic layer. This is the neck of the sac, and it is the determining factor for hernia accidents such as obstruction or strangulation. So this is the basic portion, that slide representing the hernia formation. We have a weakness in the abdominal wall through which a viscus is going to protrude. And once it protrudes, it will form a bulging, and that is known as the hernia. There can be different kinds of hernias. We might have inguinal hernias, which are direct or indirect. We might have a femoral hernia in the femoral canal. We can have umbilical hernias, which are either congenital or acquired. We can have hernias in the epigastric region. We can have incisional hernias, hernias in the linea semilunaris. We can have lumbar, and we can have internal hernias, and sometimes we may also have hernia which occurs due to weakness or separation of the recti. Some basic hernia terminology that we are going to cover in this slide. Hernias can either be reducible or irreducible. Reducibility means that the hernia can be returned to its normal position in the peritoneal cavity simply by physical manipulation. For instance, if you have a hernia which is coming out in your inguinal region, you can simply push it back in place, and if that is happening by physical or manipulation, then that means that the hernia is reducible. If the hernia cannot be pushed back or returned to the normal place, that is an irreducible hernia. The second thing is a cuff impulse. A cuff impulse is an impulse that is felt when you are applying gentle pressure over the site of the hernia and you ask the patient to cuff. This is because cuffing increases the abdominal pressure, and that intra-abdominal pressure is transmitted to the hernia, and we can feel the resulting impulse as a cuff impulse. The third thing is that some hernias might get obstructed. Obstructed means that the bowel of fat, which are forming the contents of the hernial sac, they can get stuck inside the sac. Due to, especially this occurs when the neck of the sac is narrow. This can cause appreciable pain as well as sometimes obstruct the bowel, leading to a need for urgent surgery. And the last thing which can happen is strangulation. In strangulation, the blood supply to the bowel, which is forming the content of the sac, is cut off at the neck. This can lead to the bowel becoming ischemic and dying, and it can also lead to perforation. Now we first come to inguinal hernias. Inguinal hernias constitute around 75% of all abdominal hernias. Inguinal hernias are occurring in the inguinal canal. They can be direct or indirect. Indirect inguinal hernias are usually congenital in origin. They occur due to a persistent patent processus vaginalis. Direct inguinal hernias are usually acquired hernias. Inguinal hernias usually occur in male. Around 86% of inguinal hernias occur in male.
Why the reason for this is that the spermatic cord in males passes through the inguinal.
The most common type of inguinal hernia is an indirect inguinal hernia. These constitute around 2/3 of all inguinal hernias. They have a congenital origin. So, indirect inguinal hernias occur because of a patent processus vaginalis. The processus vaginalis is an outpouching of peritoneum that forms the inguinal canal inside the fetus. So, if this processus vaginalis is usually obliterated in adults, but if it remains patent, then it can lead to a potential hernial formation. And the hernias which occur in this way, they are indirect inguinal hernias. Indirect inguinal hernias are more common in males, around 20 times more common in males, and they occur on the right side. They are more common in children and adolescents. The root of the hernial sac in this case is that it will enter the inguinal canal through the deep inguinal ring. Once it enters the inguinal canal, at the point of entry, it will be lateral to the inferior epigastric vessels. You should remember the inferior epigastric vessels is a very important landmark for inguinal hernias, because indirect inguinal hernias always pass lateral to these vessels, whereas direct inguinal hernias pass medial to these vessels. The root of the sac, after it passes inside the inguinal canal, it will either extend partly through the length of the inguinal canal, or it will extend completely through the length of the inguinal canal and come out through the superficial inguinal ring. In this case, it may extend as far as the scrotum in males or the labia majorum in females. In this diagram, you can see the course of an indirect inguinal hernia. It has entered in the inguinal canal lateral to the inferior epigastric vessels. It has passed the deep inguinal ring, and if it passes the superficial inguinal ring, it can go into the scrotum, which contains the testes. As you can see, that this hernia, basically the sac of this hernia, is being formed by a patent. The second kind of inguinal hernia is a direct inguinal hernia. Direct inguinal hernias constitute around 15% of all inguinal hernias. They are usually acquired and they occur in old males who have weak abdominal muscles. They are very rare in women. In this case, as we can see, the hernial sac, it bulges directly anteriorly through the posterior wall of the inguinal canal in the region of the inguinal triangle or Hasselbalch triangle. This is the diagram which represents the Hasselbalch triangle. We have the rectus abdominis muscle over here. We have the inferior epigastric vessels over here, and we have the inguinal ligament over here. So this Hasselbalch triangle is bounded medially by the lateral border of the rectus abdominis muscle. It is bounded laterally by the inferior epigastric vessels and inferiorly by the inguinal ligament. So we can see that any structure that bulges through this inguinal triangle or Hasselbalch triangle will be medial to the inferior epigastric vessels. The neck of the hernial sac is usually wide due to the strong conjoint tendon. This is the conjoint tendon that you can see over here. This is the rectus abdominis, and this is the site for hernia formation in case of direct inguinal hernia. As you can see, it is medial to the inferior epigastric. So in this short table, we will compare the differences between indirect and direct hernias. So in this diagram that you can see the abdominal musculature over here, you can see the epigastric vessels, and you can see the peritoneum. Indirect inguinal hernias, they project through the inguinal ring into the inguinal canal, and their passageway is usually lateral to the epigastric vessels. Whereas direct inguinal hernias, they project through the abdominal wall directly and medial to the epigastric vessels. The predisposing factors of a direct hernia are weakness of the anterior abdominal wall in the region of the Hasselbalch triangle. This can be due to the distended superficial ring. It can also be due to attenuation of the aponeurosis in males who are greater than 40 years of age. Whereas indirect hernias are usually congenital, and they occur due to patency of the processus vaginalis, which can be either completely patent or at least partially patent in the superior part. And these usually occur in younger patients, the greater majority of which are males. The direct hernias are less common, we have already studied that, whereas indirect hernias are more common. The direct hernias, they exit from the abdominal cavity directly, so they are covered by peritoneum plus the transversalis fascia. Whereas indirect hernias, they pass through the inguinal canal, so their coverings of the hernial sac in this case would be the peritoneum, as well as all the three facial coverings of the spermatic cord or the round ligament. The course of these hernias we have done in the previous slides. The direct hernia exits from the anterior abdominal wall usually via the superficial ring lateral to the spermatic cord, and it very, very rarely enters the scrotum.
Whereas the indirect hernias, they exit via the superficial ring inside the spermatic cord, not lateral to it. And they can pass to a very important slide on how to palpate for a hernia. So the first thing that we need to do is to palpate the superficial and the deep inguinal rings. The superficial inguinal ring is palpable superolateral to the pubic tubercle. You follow the spermatic cord in the region superolateral to the pubic tubercle, and then you can palpate the superficial inguinal ring. The deep inguinal ring is also palpable superior to the inguinal ligament and superolateral to the pubic tubercle, around 2 to 4 cm superolateral to it. Once you know how to palpate the superficial and the deep rings, you then place your finger at the superficial inguinal ring and you ask the patient to cough. If you can palpate an impulse, that means that an inguinal hernia is present, but it does not discriminate which type of inguinal hernia is it. For instance, if you are feeling an impulse at the superficial ring and you can feel or palpate a mass at the deep ring, then this is an indirect inguinal hernia. If you occlude the deep ring and with your finger and you ask the patient to cough and a mass appears medial to the deep ring, that also indicates that this is an indirect inguinal hernia. Whereas if you are palpating the superficial inguinal ring and the impulse is felt not directly at the finger, which is at the superficial inguinal ring, but rather medial to it, then this is a direct hernia. Again, another method of palpating for a direct hernia is that you palpate directly over the Hasselbalch triangle with your index or middle finger and then ask the patient to cough or strain. We will review the principles for palpating a hernia again in this slide. Let me just get my pen. Over here you can see the superficial inguinal ring, and over here you can see the site for the deep inguinal ring. As you can see, if this is the pubic tubercle, then the superficial inguinal ring can be palpated superolaterally to it, whereas the deep inguinal ring can also be palpated 2 to 4 cm superolateral to the pubic tubercle and over the inguinal ligament. The deep inguinal ring is situated around 1.5 cm above the mid inguinal point. If you palpate a hernia in this direction, the red vessels which we can see over here, these are the inferior epigastric vessels. So if you palpate a hernia in this direction, in the medial region, in the region which is medial to the inferior epigastric vessels, this part, as you can see, represents the Hasselbalch triangle. So if you palpate a hernia in this area, that means it is a direct inguinal hernia. Now if the root of the indirect inguinal hernia is this, that it enters into the deep inguinal ring, then it passes through the deep inguinal ring and it can pass through the superficial ring inside the scrotum. So if you are placing your finger at the superficial inguinal ring like this, you're placing your finger at the superficial inguinal ring and you ask the patient to cough. If you feel an impulse at the superficial inguinal ring and you see a mass at the deep inguinal ring, that is one way of indicating that this is a indirect inguinal hernia. The second way is that if you place your thumb over the deep ring and you occlude this deep ring, okay, and then you ask the patient to cough, the resultant hernia will appear medial to the deep ring. This is again an indication that this is a indirect inguinal hernia. This slide again represents the same principles that we have previously seen for the formation of indirect and direct inguinal hernias. As you can see, this is the deep inguinal ring over here. This is the superficial inguinal ring. If a hernial sac enters through the deep inguinal ring and then it traverses through the inguinal canal inside the spermatic cord and either comes out or stays inside the inguinal canal, or comes out through the superficial inguinal ring into the scrotum or the labia majors, this is an indirect inguinal hernia. Whereas if we have a direct inguinal hernia, that will basically appear as a bulge in the anterior abdominal wall in the region of the inguinal triangle, and it will always be medial to the inferior epigastric vessels. The hernial sac in this case, in the case of a direct hernia, is medial to the inferior epigastric vessels, whereas the hernial sac in this case is lateral to the inferior epigastric vessels. One more thing that you can see is that the portion through which the hernial sac is passing through, in the case of an indirect hernia, that hernial sac is being. This is your first assignment question or clinical scenario. A 65-year-old male with a history of chronic cough notices a gradually increasing swelling in his left groin. After physical examination, the surgeon notices that we have a lemon-sized swelling above and lateral to the pubic tubercle, which increases in size on cuffing. Once he manually reduces the swelling, the surgeon occludes the deep inguinal ring with his thumb and then asks the patient to cough. The swelling then appears medial to the thumb of the surgeon. So you need to answer which kind of hernia this is and why. You need to give the differences between direct and indirect inguinal hernias, and you need to enumerate the different parts of a hernia. Your important takeaway from inguinal hernias is that in the case of inguinal hernias, the neck of sac is always above and medial to the pubic tubercle. Once you know that information, you need to differentiate whether the hernia is direct or indirect, and for that you need to look at whether it is appearing lateral or medial to the inferior epigastric vessels. If a hernia is appearing lateral to the inferior epigastric vessels, it is an indirect hernia, whereas if it is appearing medial to the inferior epigastric vessels, that is a direct hernia. Femoral hernias, in the case of femoral hernias, the neck of the sac is always below and lateral to the pubic tubercle in the region of the femoral canal. So if we have this dot indicating the pubic tubercle, you can see that the neck of a inguinal hernia is above. And the second kind of hernia that we are going to cover is an umbilical hernia. Umbilical hernias can be either congenital or acquired. They are more common in newborns, especially low birth weight babies, in which case the anterior abdominal wall is weak in the umbilical ring. They occur due to increased intra-abdominal pressure if the anterior abdominal wall is already weak, or they can also occur if the anterior abdominal wall is partially defected after ligation of the umbilical cord at birth. So over here you can see that we have a hernia in the umbilical region. We have the umbilicus, and we have a weakness in the anterior abdominal wall through which peritoneum and along with coils of intestine and fat is protruding through. Umbilical hernias present rather differently in infants and adults. In infants, umbilical hernias can either be congenital or they can be acquired. Congenital umbilical hernias are caused by a failure of the midgut to return to the abdominal cavity from the extraembryonic coelom during fetal life. You will study this in the GI embryology, that the midgut comes out of the abdominal cavity because there is not enough space in it during the fetal life, and then it returns to it as the abdominal cavity grows in size. If the midgut doesn't not return to the abdominal cavity and remains inside the extraembryonic coelom, then that can lead to a congenital umbilical hernia, which is also known as an exomphalos or omphalocele. You can see this in this picture. We have the linea alba, we have the peritoneum, and we have the midgut herniating in the region of the umbilical cord. Acquired umbilical hernias usually occur due to weakness in the scar of umbilicus in the linea alba. So this is the linea alba, this is the region of the umbilicus. We have a weakness in the scar of the umbilicus that is present after ligation of the umbilical cord. And over here, an acquired. In adults, umbilical hernias appear in a different way. They are usually referred to more appropriately as paraumbilical hernias. These paraumbilical hernias mostly occur in females and obese people. In this case, the hernial sac protrudes through the linea alba in the region of the umbilicus. The reason for this is that there are gaps which are occurring at the site of abdominal aponeurosis or from the transition of the external oblique aponeurosis to the rectus sheath. And these gaps can exist due to any congenital cause. They can occur in obese patients, they can occur after any surgery or trauma, or they can occur due to aging. So as you can see over here, we have the linea alba over here, this in this black. The blue portion represents the peritoneum, and we have the umbilicus a little bit on downwards. We have the umbilicus over here. So near the umbilicus, what happens is that there is a gap in the linea alba, and through this gap the hernial contents and sac will protrude from the anterior abdominal wall. We can also see that when this paraumbilical hernia occurs, it displaces the belly button to one side, and as it grows in size, it will hang downwards, it will be pulled downwards due to the effect of gravity. The neck of this hernia is usually narrow, and the body can contain coils or loops of small and large intestine or omentum. A narrow neck. The next kind of hernia is an epigastric hernia. These hernias are common in middle-aged manual workers. They occur in the midline,
in the region of the epigastrium between the xiphoid process and the umbilicus. Over here, the linea alba is usually wide. It's not narrow, it's wide over here. And in this wide region, we can have a small protrusion of the extraperitoneal fat between the different layers of the linea alba, and that can constitute an epigastric hernia. These epigastric hernias, the fat that is protruding out can usually drag some peritoneum along with it as well, and can contain a small piece of the greater omentum as well. So over here you can see that the where my pointer is at, this is the umbilicus, this is the linea alba over here. And in the wide portion of the linea alba extending from the xiphoid to the umbilicus, at any side there can be protrusion of the extra peritoneal fat between the layers of the linea alba. Again, in this diagram, you can see that this is the rectus abdominis muscle with its sheath. The next kind of hernia is an incisional hernia. Incisional hernias usually occur when we have given an incision in the region of the abdomen, and we cut one of the segmental nerves, which is supplying the muscle of the anterior abdominal wall. This can result in weakness or paralysis of the muscles, and this can predispose to a hernia over the site of the incision. Secondarily, incisional hernias can also result when there is a postoperative wound infection over an abdominal incision, which leads to necrosis of the abdominal muscles. So once the abdominal muscles die, they become weak in that specific area, and a hernial sac can bulge through that area. The neck of this sac is usually large, and the adhesion and strangulation of its contents is relatively rare. In very obese individuals, the extent of the abdominal wall weakness is often difficult to assess. So as you can see, this portion that I'm highlighting used to be an incision, and over here there was another type of hernias that we usually encounter are Spigelian hernias. These occur along the linea semilunaris through the aponeurosis of the transverse abdominis, just lateral to the lateral edge of the rectus sheath. So over here in this diagram, you can see this is the rectus abdominis muscle, this is this rectus sheath, and this is the transverse abdominis muscle. So just lateral to the lateral edge of the rectus sheath, in the portion which is covered by the aponeurosis of the transversus abdominis muscle, we have the semilunar line, and this portion is being covered by the Spigelian fascia. This represents a potential site of weakness through which contents can protrude out and form a Spigelian hernia. It is more common in patients who are greater than 40 years and obese. The hernial sac of peritoneum is only covered with the skin and subcutaneous tissue in this case. Usually these kind of hernias, they occur below the level of the umbilicus, and they can be Another hernia that we might encounter is the lumbar hernia. This usually occurs in the back, in the lumbar triangle of Petit. The lumbar triangle is bounded anteriorly by the external oblique muscle, posteriorly by the latissimus dorsi muscle, and inferiorly by the iliac crest. So in this region, the lumbar triangle of Petit, the floor of this triangle that is being formed by the internal oblique and the transversus abdominis muscles. So if any contents herniate through this triangle in the back, that is known as a lumbar hernia, and which these hernias usually have a low incidence. Another kind of hernia that we might encounter is an internal hernia. Basically what happens is that the peritoneum inside the body cavity, in the abdominal cavity, it has certain recesses. And if a loop of intestine enters a peritoneal recess and it gets strangulated at the edge of the recess, that can lead to an internal hernia. Sometimes what happens is that after surgery, adhesions form within the peritoneal cavity, and they create abnormal pockets in which the bowel can enter and become trapped as well. So we can see that this is a peritoneal recess, and as you can see, a loop of intestine has entered into the recess. It has the potential of being strangulated. Another usually rare hernia that we can encounter is a Richter's hernia. In this case, let's see, this is the bowel wall. As we can see, it has two walls. So the bowel has two walls. In the case of a Richter's hernia, only one wall of the bowel that enters is going to enter inside the hernial sac. And since it can only one wall is entering, it has the potential to become necrotic and perforate. Over here we have your second assignment. Let's see if you can solve the clinical scenario. We have a 35-year-old male who has a soft mass approximately 3 cm in diameter in his right scrotum. Palpation in the region of the superficial inguinal ring is showing a palpable cuff impulse. The testes were felt separately from the mass, and the mass was not tender on examination. So can you tell what type of hernia this is based on the history and the clinical examination findings?
You need to give the boundaries of the inguinal triangle, and you need to show how you will differentiate between inguinal and femoral hernias for this assignment. One more thing that can occur is divarication of the recti. Divarication means that the two recti, they separate from each other. This usually occurs in elderly multiparous women who have had a lot of babies and who have weak abdominal muscles due to stretching of the abdominal wall during pregnancy. The aponeurosis, which is forming the rectus sheath, becomes excessively stretched in this case. So when the patient cuffs or strains, the recti, they separate from each other. And once they separate from each other, a large hernial sac, which can contain abdominal viscera, this bulges forward between the medial margins of the two recti. So you can see the medial margins of the two recti over here, and the hernial sac is just bulging out from this region. And you can correct this divarication of recti by wearing an Now that we have covered abdominal hernias, we move on to abdominal incisions. These incisions are made by surgeons to gain access to different regions, different organs which are present inside the abdominal cavity. The incisions usually follow Langer lines, which are cleavage lines on the skin, and these lines are followed so that we get a good cosmetic result. Good incisions are the ones which provide adequate exposure and secondarily have good cosmetic outcomes. The location of the incision will depend upon the type of operation that we are doing, the location of the organ the surgeon wants to reach, the surrounding bony or cartilaginous boundaries. We need to avoid the motor nerves so that we do not cause weakness of the muscles of the abdomen. We need to maintain the blood supply while we are making an incision, and we need to minimize injury to muscles and fascia of the abdominal wall while aiming for favorable healing. So a general rule is that we should not transect muscles. We should either incise between or in the direction of the muscular fibers. An exception to this is the rectus abdominis, because its fibers, they are going to insert into aponeurotic sheaths. After the incising, muscle and viscera, they are retracted towards their neurovascular supply, not away from, because if you retract them away from their neurovascular supply, it will lead to excessive stretching and can injure the neurovascular bundles. Over here, we have a brief classification of the different incisions that we commonly use. Some incisions can be vertical or longitudinal. These include the midline incision, which is made in the midline, and the paramedian incision, which is made slightly lateral, 2 to 5 centimeters lateral to the midline. Then we have the abdominothoracic incisions, which allow for access to organs in the abdominal as well as the thoracic cavity. We also have transverse and oblique incisions, one example of which is the Cocker subcostal incision. Over here, this is the Cocker subcostal incision. As indicated from its name, it is given in the subcostal region. Then we have the transverse muscle dividing incision, the McBurney's muscle splitting incision, or the gridiron incision. We also have a Fennin-Steel incision over here, which is used for cesarean sections. And we also have some minor incisions, which we are not really going to cover in this presentation. The first incision that we are going to cover is the vertical, midline, or median incision. The extent of this incision usually is from the xiphoid process to the level of the umbilicus, if it is a supraumbilical incision, and we can also extend it from the umbilicus till the pubic symphysis, making it an infraumbilical incision. When we are making an infraumbilical incision, we need to curve it at its lower margin so that we avoid injury to the bladder. The structures we pass while making a midline incision are the skin, the superficial fascia, the linea alba in the midline, the fascia transversalis, the extraperitoneal connective tissue, and the peritoneum. The advantages of this incision are, I'm going to just draw the incision over here. This is the supraumbilical part. Then we curve a little bit around the umbilicus. Then we make the infraumbilical part. And once we reach the region of the bladder, we curve it again a little bit laterally to avoid bladder injury. The advantages of this incision are that it's relatively bloodless, no muscle fibers are divided, no nerves are injured, it provides us good access to the upper abdominal viscera, and it is very quick to make. The disadvantages are that it can lead to incisional hernias in the lower abdomen, where the linea alba is narrow and the recti lie closely to each other after poor suturing techniques. And the second disadvantage is that we can injure the bladder in the suprapubic region. This is the main incision that we use during a laparotomy to gain access to the abdominal cavity. It is also an incision which we can use during laparoscopy to induce insert the trocar. The second incision that we are going to cover is the paramedian incision. This is an incision which is usually given in the sagittal plane, 2 to 5 centimeters lateral to the midline. And it is given in 2 to 5 centimeters lateral to the midline over the medial aspect of the rectus abdominis. So this is an incision that we are giving directly over the bulging convexity of the rectus abdominis. It usually extends from this area over here, the costal margin, to the pubic hairline. Now the tissues that we are going to cut it are the skin, the subcutaneous tissues. Then we cut through the anterior wall of the rectus sheath. When it comes to the muscle, we can either retract the muscle or divide it by cutting through it. Then we come to the posterior wall of the rectus sheath and finally the peritoneum, which we will cut. It provides access, better access to the lateral structures such as the spleen, which is on the right side, or the kidneys on either sides. Theoretically, its closure is more secure compared to the median incision because the rectus abdominis muscle over here is also closed and it acts as a buttress to provide more support for the closure. The disadvantages are that it can strip the muscle from its lateral vascular and nerve supply, which can lead to atrophy of the muscle. It does not give us good access to the other region. For instance, if we are making an incision over here on this side, on the right side, then it does not provide us good access on the left side. Our third main incision is an important one. It is Cocker's subcostal incision. This subcostal incision is given in the subcostal region over here. It is started at the midline. So we start this at the midline, 2 to 5 centimeters from the xiphoid process, which is over here. And then we extend it downwards, outwards, and parallel to the costal margin. The structures we are going to cut are the skin, the subcutaneous tissue. We will obviously cut through the anterior layer of the rectus sheath and the external oblique muscle. We will also cut through the rectus abdominis muscle. If we encounter the superficial epigastric vessels, we may need to ligate them over here. Then we will come to the posterior layer of the rectus sheath, the anterior internal oblique, and the transversus abdominal muscles, and finally the peritoneum. This incision it is used to provide exposure to the gallbladder and the biliary tract. Mainly, this incision is given on the right side for a cholecystectomy, which is the removal of the gallbladder. But we can also extend this incision on the left side if we need to provide exposure to the spleen as well. So if we extend the same incision to the left side, it becomes a rooftop incision, which combines subcostal incisions on both sides of the midline. And sometimes if we need even further access to the organs which are present in the upper abdominal cavity, we can extend this incision upwards towards the xiphoid process, as you can see over here. This makes the Mercedes-Benz sign and is named the Mercedes-Benz incision. These modifications of the Cocker subcostal incision provide us greater access to the abdominal viscera and to carry out abdominal operations such as a liver transplant. The disadvantages are that the 8th thoracic nerve has to be divided, and if we accidentally cut through the 9th one as well, it can lead to weakness of the... Another main incision that we deal with is the McBurney's incision. In the case of the McBurney's incision, this is the classical incision which we use for an appendectomy. It is a very good incision because it has good healing and cosmetic appearance. This incision is usually made by first identifying the McBurney's point. So to identify the McBurney's point, you draw a line extending from the anterior superior iliac spine to the umbilicus. This is the line that is extending from the anterior superior iliac spine to the umbilicus. At the junction of the outer thirds and the middle thirds of this line right over here, this is the McBurney's point. So we start this incision from the McBurney's point, and now we can give this incision in an either oblique fashion or in a transverse fashion along the skin lines, which is the Lance modification of this incision. The structures we cut through are the skin, the subcutaneous tissue. Over here, we will cut the external oblique aponeurosis in the direction of its fibers. This is a very important point. We will cut the external oblique aponeurosis in the direction of its fibers. Then we come to the internal oblique muscle and the transversus abdominis muscle. These two will either be cut in the direction of their fibers, or we can also cut through them in the same direction that was used to cut through the external oblique aponeurosis. Once we have done this, then we can cut through the peritoneum. The nerves that we need to save over here are the iliohypogastric and the ilioinguinal nerves. These nerves are usually seen when the internal oblique and transversus are cut, so we can see the nerves between them, and we should avoid damaging them, because if we're damaging them, it will weaken the effect that usually is exerted by these muscles on the inguinal canal, and it will predispose to the formation of an inguinal hernia. Another structure that can be damaged is the ascending branch of the deep circumflex iliac artery, which can be damaged while extending this incision laterally. The McBurney's incision is also known as the gridiron incision. So another modification of this McBurney's incision is the one in which we cut the external oblique aponeurosis in the line of its fibers, and then we cut through the internal oblique and the transversus abdominis muscles in the same direction, in the same plane in which we cut through the external oblique. This provides us greater access to structures which are underlying, such as the colon, and in this modification known as the Rutherford-Morrison incision is another very important classical incision that we use is the Fannin-Steele incision. So this Fannin-Steele incision is the classical incision that we use for a C-section. This incision is made above the pubic symphysis. So we have the pubic symphysis over here, around 3 to 5 centimeters above the pubic symphysis. We will make a transverse incision of around 12 centimeters in length, which will extend laterally as far as the lateral borders of the rectus sheath. So we will cut through the skin, the subcutaneous tissue. We will divide the anterior layer of the rectus sheath and the rectus muscles. You need to remember that the posterior layer of the rectus sheath is deficient in this region. Then we will cut the linea alba in the vertical plane and remove the extraperitoneal connective tissue, and finally we will cut through the peritoneum to reach the uterus. This incision offers excellent cosmetic results because the scar can be hidden by the patient's pubic hair, but it also provides us limited exposure to other pelvic organs such as the prostate or bladder. And it's the last major incision that we need to cover is the abdominal thoracic incision. As we said above, this is an incision which provides us access to both the abdominal and the thoracic cavities. So to make this incision, we will first make a paramedian abdominal incision. We will extend it upwards and laterally into the 7th, 8th or 9th intercostal space, and then we will transect the costal arch and incise the diaphragm. So basically we have extended a paramedian incision upwards and then laterally through the intercostal space to access the structures inside the thorax. On the right side, we use this incision when we need to remove a portion of the liver. On the left side, we use it when we need to access the esophagus or the stomach, the lower esophagus or the proximal stomach, which are present inside the esophagus, inside the thorax. There are a couple of incisions which are high risk due to their complications. These are the pararectus and the inguinal incisions. The pararectus incision, which is made along the lateral border of the rectus abdominis, in this incision we can transect the nerve supply of the rectus abdominis and lead to weakening and subsequent predisposition for the formation of an incisional hernia. Whereas the inguinal incision, which we make for the repair of an inguinal hernia, can injure the ilioinguinal nerve. So minimally invasive surgery, also known as endoscopy, or in the case of abdomen, is also known as laparoscopy. In this case, we make tiny perforations or holes in the abdominal wall, and we enter our instruments through it to replace the conventional incisions that we make. The advantages of minimally invasive surgery are that it reduces the potential for nerve injury, incisional hernia or contamination that can occur through the open wound. It also decreases the time required for healing. The disadvantages of this incision are that the surgical field is relatively small and we are limited in our extent of operation. This can be used for the removal of gallbladder and appendix, among other procedures. High yield points for in the abdominal incisions. The midline incision is relatively bloodless. The complication of this incision can be an incisional hernia. So the Cocker's incision on the right side, we use it to access the gallbladder and biliary tract. On the left side, we can extend it to use access to the spleen. We have a classical incision for appendectomy is a McBurney's incision, and its complication can be an inguinal hernia. Why? Because of injury to the iliohypogastric nerves. The classical incision for a C-section is a Fannin-Steele incision. We can also use a lumbar incision to access the kidney and the ureter. Incisions along the skin lines always heal with minimal scarring and best cosmetic results. So these are some high yield points which can be useful for your MCQs. Now we have the six Fs, which are the causes of abdominal protuberance. These include food, fat, flatus, fetus, feces and fluid.
So basically, these are the things that can lead your abdomen or tummy to protrude out from its normal appearance. Because of these causes, the abdomen intra-abdominal pressure can be increased, and this can also lead to eversion of the umbilicus. This video will show you how an inguinal hernia can result. Over here, you can see the groin, and you can see the region of the inguinal canal, the spermatic cord passing through the canal and the urinary bladder. The inguinal canal is bounded by the superficial and the deep inguinal rings, as we already know. So an inguinal hernia occurs when there is a weakness in the abdominal wall and intestine and some of the structure will slip out through this inguinal canal. It will pass through the deep inguinal ring, and it can also pass into the canal. If it passes through the superficial inguinal ring, it will pass inside the spermatic cord and can lead to a bulge or swelling inside the scrotum. That will be an indirect inguinal hernia. That's all from our lecture today. Thank you so much.